Please open your Bibles to Hebrews chapter 3. If you are sitting near someone who doesn't have a Bible, if you could find one in the chair around you and help them find their place in Hebrews 3, or you could share your Bible with them, well, that would be greatly appreciated. But we want everyone to know that what is preached this morning does come from the Scripture, from the Word of God. Here we are in Hebrews chapter 3. When you find the place there, kind of look up this way so I know that you found it. As we get into the Scripture this morning, we just want to do a couple of things by way of review while people are turning there. One, I want to remind us to whom the letter to the Hebrews is written. It is written to Hebrew believers in Jesus Christ. You know, most of the time, most Christians don't think of the church as being from Jerusalem, but that's where the church got started at. And if you study and read through Acts, one of the things you'll come to understand based on the population of Jerusalem at the time, the population of Jerusalem would have been somewhere around 100,000. And if you go through Acts and you look at how many individuals came to Christ, how many of the Jews in Jerusalem came to Christ, you'll understand that more than 50,000 of the individuals who were at Jerusalem became believers in Jesus Christ. And so you ask the question, well, where's the church at in Jerusalem today? Well, actually, it's a phenomenon that Jews live in Jerusalem today, actually. Do we know this? You know, most of us have been born post-1948. And so we don't think of the fact that Palestine was really not occupied by the Jews for a long period of time. But that the Jews are now moving back to the land that God promised them. When the letter to the Hebrews was written, Jews had continually occupied Jerusalem from the time that God gave them the land when they marched into the land of Canaan, into the promised land. And so it had been continuously occupied. But things were very, very tense politically at the moment when this letter to the Hebrew Christians was written. What was happening was that there was a rebellion, a revolt. You can read about it. You can read about it in the Maccabees. You can read about it in intertestamental history. About what happened at Jerusalem when that final revolt under the Roman Empire came, and literally the temple was destroyed and desecrated, and Jerusalem was sacked, and the people were literally taken out of Jerusalem and scattered all around the Roman province, if not killed, were actually scattered around. And the time the Holy Spirit gave us Hebrews was around 68 AD, so about 2 years out. And things were fomenting. Things were beginning to be stirred up. You could tell that things were about to get bad at that time. Now, we don't think, because we think of the times and age in which we live, Israel, my entire life has existed as a nation. I thank God for that. The existence of national Israel is an evident indication that God has preserved His people and that God has a future plan with His people. God is not done with Israel. The day is going to come when instead of working through the church, God will work exclusively through national Israel. And God's preservation of His people, the Jews, in every nation is an evidence that there's a God. Some people say, I don't believe there's a God. Well, my friend, let me just tell you something. National Israel, every Jew you meet is a testimony that there's a God. Why so, Pastor? Well, you explain to me how a couple million people came out of Egypt and lived in the wilderness for 40 years. You give me an explanation for people, even 2 million people, at least 2 million people, probably 2.5, maybe as many as 4 million people, migrating from Egypt as being slaves. And that, by the way, is a historical fact. It's not debatable where the Jew came from. It's not a debate. It happened. And lived in the wilderness for 40 years. You explain to me a couple million people living in a desert. You can go to those places today and you can see they're as barren as they ever were, and yet they survived in the wilderness. How'd they survive? God gave them food. And God gave them water. You try and take 10 people out in the desert and survive. One person, you know, maybe you can find some rats and lizards and snakes. Probably not rats, but maybe lizards and snakes, and you could survive. But try and feed a couple million. The snakes run out real quick. You know, they're gone fast. Now, I'm being a little bit facetious, but I'm being as serious as I possibly can in saying that the national existence of Israel, the fact that they went into the land of Canaan, and God, I mean, people who have gone from being slaves, go into a land where people are warriors. You don't do that. You don't. People who are migrants don't go in and take over a country by force. But God drove the Canaanites out of the land for them. And it's a proof that there's a God. The second reason that every person who you meet who is Israel or Hebrew according to the flesh is an evidence that there's a God is the preservation of their identity. You know who the Jews are in any culture, in any country around the world. You can scatter Jews, but you know who they are. And they'll be together, and they'll have a national identity. Gu was telling me the other day, there are a lot of Jews in China. I said, Gu, there are a lot of Jews anywhere you go. And where you go, you'll know who they are. You can go to any country in South America, find a Jewish community. You can go to any country in Europe and find a Jewish community, in spite of the atrocities that were done that tried to make that not so. Why? Because God loves them. And God is preserving them. But they, the national Israel, those who were not believers in Jesus, were persecuting those who were believers in Jesus Christ. And so you are really in double jeopardy. This is the letter to Hebrews. It's written to a people that are really going through a hard time, double jeopardy. In other words, they were born and they were born hated. Anti-Semitism boggles my mind. It is so irrational. And it is so pervasive. You know, you'd think if something were irrational, it would be rare, right? If something's unreasonable, there wouldn't be a lot of it. But I'm just telling you something. Anti-Semitism is both irrational and pervasive. In other words, it doesn't make any sense. It's not logical. It's not reasonable. And yet, it's everywhere you go. Isn't it true? I remember the first time, we didn't have many Jews where I was growing up, and I grew up in a Christian, in Christian circles, and really was kind of sheltered from anti-Semitism, to be honest with you, because we just loved Israel. We grew up loving Israel. We met someone who was Jewish. We're like, awesome, you're Jewish. God loves you. You know, God's going to use you. God's going to do something great with you. First time I moved to Southeast Florida, I moved to Delray Beach, which at the time was 33% Jewish. And in our teen camp, had about 15 to 20 kids that Melissa and I were their camp counselors for every day. And I'm going to tell you something. Those kids who were like 12 years old would say things that at first I didn't even understand them. I didn't even know what the lingo was. But they would say the most terrible things. Children would say the most terrible things about God's people, the Jews. And they weren't church kids. They were camp kids. They hadn't grown up in our church. They weren't from our church. They learned it somewhere, and I would ask them, where do you learn this? Well, you know, when kids say something, they get it from two places, right? Two places. School and their parents. Right? They really do. They get it from school and from their parents. I'll just tell you something. In Delray Beach, where 33% of the population at the time was Jewish, there's a lot of anti-Semitism in the public school system. A ton of it. I mean, awful stuff. And the conspiracy theories that always blame the Jews for everything is there. It's pervasive. Anyone wants to say there's any kind of problems in government or politics, anti-Semitism creeps right into it. It's nonsensical. It makes no sense. As I said before, it's irrational and it's pervasive. And yet, in spite of that irrational hatred in every generation, in spite of how pervasive it is, God's people, the Jews, have multiplied and been a blessing in every nation. Isn't that wonderful? And it's a proof that there's a God. It's an evidence that there's God. I'm just telling you something. You don't understand anti-Semitism. It's anti-God. People hate Jews because they hate the fact that they have God's mark on them. They honestly do. They God is preserving them. You know, you kind of hate the juggernaut, right? You hate the person who there's nothing you can do to win. You know, you're going to go against. I'm going to tell you something. You go against, and this is not an anti-Semitic statement. You go against a person who has God's blessing on them because they're Jewish, you're not going to win. You can't win. Even when God has judged them, and even when they're under judgment, why in the world then were the Jews driven out of Jerusalem ultimately? Well, because God promised them if they didn't keep His covenants, if they didn't worship Him the way they're supposed to, that would happen as a result. But there's a special, unique people group because they're Hebrews and they're also Christians. They're Jewish believers in Jesus Christ. And that was all there were in the early church as far as believers. The only believers were Jewish. There were no Gentile believers in the early church. It didn't happen until Antioch when so many Gentiles got saved that they became called Christians instead of just Jews. Before that, believers in Jesus were just Jews. There was no Jews aren't Christians, only Jews were Christians. And historically, that's the early church. Okay, so what had happened up to that point? Well, if you study Acts, you realize that the persecution in Jerusalem was so great that only the apostles remained in Jerusalem. So you had the apostles, 12 people, and probably a scattering of people, but the majority of Christians were scattered all over the Roman Empire because of persecution. That's how the gospel of Jesus was preached and how the Gentiles were reached with the gospel. And that's how today more people that are Gentiles know Jesus. It's because of the Jews that were scattered and preached the gospel of Jesus Christ. But those individuals were in double jeopardy, as I said in the beginning, because if their family did not follow Jesus, which would normally have often happened, then their family would cast them out. Their family, literally, they would become an outcast after following Jesus because there was too much political pressure. Listen, the Pharisees and the scribes, the political establishment, the Sadducees, the established religion, which was a political establishment. It wasn't scriptural. Didn't follow the law in the scripture. That establishment was completely intolerant of them. And so you got saved, you came home, and you told your parents, and they didn't receive Jesus. They said, I no longer have a son. Everybody was part of the family business. They said, you're no longer part of this business. You have no inheritance. And then there was that continual family question. You don't stop loving your parents, right? But if your parents cast you out, that's pretty tough, isn't it? So could we say that we could understand, at least intellectually, we can understand the hardship of the Hebrew Christians? They were hated because they were born Jews. And on top of that, they were not only outcast in the Roman Empire, they were outcast in their own families. And that's pretty tough.
Doesn't that still happen? Like a lot of Jews...
I have a friend who was born into a Jewish family at 16 years old. He trusted Christ, went home, told his parents, and they kicked him out at 16.
Still happening.
Yeah, still happens. But... it's more unusual today, I would say. I'm not the expert on that, but yeah. By the way, happens with Catholics.
Yeah.
Happens with Muslims. I have a friend whose dad has money on him, like $500,000 on him, a hit, and he's been bombed. He's been shot. You know, he's from the Middle East. He's Muslim, and his dad, who is a high up. I forget what kind of Muslim, but he's high up in Islam. His dad's put a hit on him. I mean, his own dad is trying to kill him. And he's been like for 30 years he's survived. But, you know, I mean, he's been shot at in the United States. So, you know, it's a pretty serious issue. So to say, you know, yeah, this is Judaism that does this. No. Religion cannot stand for its adherence to leave, because friend, I have said this many times, religion is about power. It's about power, or it's about money. Money is power, but it's about controlling people. And if someone leaves, you no longer have control. So religion tries to clamp down, and all religion is that way. I'll just tell you something. I've met individuals that claim to be Christians, and that are Baptist. That I'll tell you something. If you disagree with them, or if you leave their particular group, they're a cult-like. They can't stand to have somebody disagree with them. So it's pervasive. So, you know, I think to answer that question, I would say, you know, that's a stereotype that doesn't even need to be made, because it's so true of error. Individuals that try to control somebody for finances or for just to have people follow them or to have them under their thumb, they're not going to let you out easy. You're not going to get out easy. Sort of like joining a gym. Okay, all right. But these Hebrew Christians were going through a great deal of suffering. Consequently, many of them had asked the question. They'd asked the soul-searching question. Any of y'all have ever tried to cancel a gym membership before? It's better in the last 10 years, but I remember my first gym membership. You know, it was quite an ordeal. I had my clavicle or something broken. And I couldn't work out, so I decided, you know, I was young, didn't have much of an income. I decided I didn't want to pay the $20 a month. So I went to the gym, said I'd like to cancel my membership. You know, I had to pay $200 to have a membership back then. And they said, okay, that's fine. You know, send a certified letter to this place, to so-and-so, and then next year, or, you know, then you can cancel. You know, that was my first education on gymnasiums. or Jim's. Anyway, okay, so that's kind of irrelevant. I was being funny and it went too far. Moving forward, the Hebrew Christians, particularly those at Jerusalem, were stopping, moving forward in their faith, following Jesus Christ. In other words, it was too much. You ever sought or tried to do something and for the Lord Jesus, and you can nod your heads or not nod your heads. You ever promised God something and then found out you promised a lot more than you knew? Your commitment was greater than your understanding of what you promised. And you found out it was harder than you thought. It wasn't going to be, you thought it was going to be easy. It wasn't easy. And all of a sudden you realized, man, this is too much. You're overwhelmed by it. These believers, we can't relate to it because none of us have ever been killed. Right? None of us, that's a pretty obvious statement, right? We better move along. I'm getting more and more intelligent as the day passes. None of us have ever had, I don't think anyone here has ever had somebody, because of following Jesus, try to kill you or take your life or the threat of it. But literally, that's what was going on in Jerusalem. By 68 AD, the apostles were hunted. Some of them had been killed. And Christians, literally, they had letters from the priests where they could go into their homes, tie them up, take them from other places around the world and bring them back to Jerusalem. And they were put to death. And they had corrupt governors that were party to that. So literally, it could be a death sentence following Jesus. And then having your family hate you on top of it, just, you know what I mean? That was the proverbial straw that broke the camel's back. It was just too much. And the letter to the Hebrews is a letter from the Holy Spirit. That's insignificant who the Holy Spirit used, whether it was Paul or someone else. Looks like Paul to me, but I don't know that. But it is significant that it is urging the believers, listen, you are in Christ, don't go back. In Hebrews, and in the study that we're doing in Hebrews right now, we're going to be in Romans in about a month, but the study we're doing right now, we're looking at the warning passages in Hebrews. So warnings about what will happen. Last week we looked at the warning of if the angels who are higher than us had the privileges that they had, and yet if the angels if every transgression and disobedience receive a just recompense of reward, how shall we escape if we neglect so great salvation? So the argument is, if God judges the angels, what's going to happen to us if we reject Jesus or we turn against Jesus? And it's a pretty frightening warning. And the answer to it we saw in our last verse in chapter 2, that Jesus Christ is how we escape, in that He Himself has suffered being tempted. He is able to succor or to sustain them that are tempted. In other words, how are we going to escape? Well, Jesus is going to help us. Let me ask you that question. I'll just ask it. How are we going to make it?
Jesus
is going to help us. And friend, that's the simple answer. That's the answer that our entire argument, which seems like, if you reject Jesus or if you neglect Jesus or if you don't live for Jesus, what's going to happen to you if God judged the angels? And the answer is,
Jesus is going to help you.
And so it goes from this frightening warning to a comforting Savior. In other words, God's going to get you through it. You're going to make it. And how comforting that is. Well, there's a second warning passage, and we'll begin in chapter 3, verse 7, reading it. We'll read it, then we'll pray, and Lord willing, we'll make 2 points this morning. And I know what they are, and I hope that you do by the time we're done. Verse 7. Wherefore, as the Holy Ghost saith, today if you will hear His voice, harden not your hearts as in the provocation, in the day of temptation in the wilderness, when your fathers tempted me, proved me, and saw my works 40 years. Wherefore I was grieved with that generation, and said, they do always err in their heart, and they have not known my ways. So I swear in my wrath, they shall not enter into my rest. Take heed, brethren, lest there be in any of you an evil heart of unbelief in departing from the living God. But exhort one another daily while it is called today, lest any of you be hardened through the deceitfulness of sin. For we are made partakers of Christ if we hold the beginning of our confidence steadfast in the end. While it is said, today if you will hear His voice, harden not your hearts, as in the provocation. For some, when they had heard, did provoke. Howbeit not all that came out of Egypt by Moses. But with whom was he grieved 40 years? Was it not with them that had sinned, whose carcasses fell in the wilderness? And to whom swear he that they should not enter into his rest? But to them that believed not, pay attention to verse 19, so we see that they could not enter in because of unbelief. Let's read that last verse again. So we see that they could not enter in because of unbelief. Okay, we'll pray and ask God to help. Lord, there is so much here in this passage of Scripture that it would be easy to be distracted by truths that are circumstantial to the major truths that you're teaching. And so I pray that you would help us with our understanding with clarity this morning to know your word and to believe it. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Belief is a choice. Belief has been a choice, and belief always will be a choice. What you believe is your choice, and that's a fact. Oh, Pastor, I have no choice but to... Well, listen, if you're rational, what you believe will make sense. If you're rational, what you believe will be correct. But I want to tell you something. Belief is not rational in and of itself. To say that somebody believes something because of logic is not always true. And actually, to some degree, there is in every one of us illogical belief. There is. The health thing is always easy to pick on because it just works. When it comes to the health thing, people believe or don't believe. Let me survey the audience. Don't get mad if you don't agree with the person. Promise you won't get mad before I survey the audience. If people don't agree with you, don't get mad. How many of you think that vaccinations are good? Now look at those people. How many of you think that vaccinations are evil? Put your hands down. Stay friends, okay? Tony's like, I don't know what to believe. People that think that vaccinations are good will point to history. And they'll point to plagues that wiped out populations. They'll point to diseases. People that believe that vaccinations are evil will point to autism. And, you know, we never had this before. And so, are they right? Are they wrong? Well, the truth of the matter is you don't know for sure. You don't really. You think you know. You know what you want to believe, but your belief is a choice. And I don't mean to be mean to you. I'm not going to tell you what I believe because I'm not sure either. But the fact of the matter is that when you look at it rationally, you got to pick a side. I mean, you got a baby and you got to stick a needle in it. You got to figure out what to do. You know, but you may have messed up badly. You may have hurt your baby. You know, just put it in the shelter. Oh! Okay, you're already settled on what's good. Okay, I didn't even pay attention to what came.
I'm with you, like, I don't know.
Yeah, okay. Well, some of the people, now that you've said that, you're going to be thrown by people. Don't vaccinate your baby! And other people, if you love your baby, you'll vaccinate him. It's terrible, right? What about the health thing, you know? What's good for you, what's bad for you? I mean, Eddie will tell you. Fat is a good thing, isn't it, Eddie? I'm talking about the
saturated fats.
Saturated fats are good for you.
That's scientific.
Okay, how many of you agree? Nick agrees, good. But your wife doesn't, does she? Oh, she does, okay, good. All right, well, very good. I wanted to divide the house, but didn't. All right, very good. Okay, so, but there are people here that would vehemently disagree with you, scientifically. And you say, well, Pastor, I don't know what to believe. Well, I'll tell you something. Saturated fats might be very bad for some people. We could agree on that, wouldn't we? I'll just tell you something. Mangoes are pretty good for me. But I know people that eat mangoes, and I'll tell you something. They'll puff up, swell up, they'll die. I mean, it's poison ivy to them. And if they breathe mango, they get sick. And, you know, I think honey is a wonderful thing. But there are people that are allergic to bees. I think bee stings have therapeutic effects for me. They make me happy. I'm just joking. I'm joking about that, but it does help my arthritis. So anyway, there are people that are just on one side or the other side of everything. And I want to tell you something. A lot of things that you are convinced about come down to a choice that you've made. In other words, you've surveyed the facts and you've figured out who you like. And you've sided with them. No, not Joe. He's too rational. I would never do that. Right? The fact of the matter is, a lot of what we believe is a choice. And if what, a lot of things we don't, you ever met somebody just wouldn't believe something? They would not believe it, and you could prove it to them, and they still wouldn't believe it. I mean, evidence had nothing to do with it. You know, that's us, every one of us. Every one of us have an irrational belief or unbelief in us. There are things that you think about people that are just not true. For instance, some of y'all think O.J. Simpson's guilty. There are some things people think about people that just aren't so. Or you don't know to be so, but you believe it. I mean, you believe it with all your heart. I've had people say, I know O.J.'s guilty. No, you don't. You actually don't. You say, yes, I do. No, you don't. You were not there, and you don't know. I think he's guilty, too. But I don't know. Because I wasn't there. I mean, if I'm honest about it, I really don't know. You don't know everything. You can't know everything, so you better know what's important and actually know it. But belief, my friend, is a choice. And the children of Israel, the illustration here is tragic because it literally is talking about people who God loves so dearly. Do you think God loved Israel? Do you think God led the children of Israel out of Egypt because he thought it would be fun and games to make them live in the wilderness? It isn't so at all. You don't believe the right thing. What you believe about God isn't true. God loved Israel. God had a plan, and they were the apple of his eye, still are the apple of his eye. And when he led them into the wilderness, my friend, it wasn't God's will, it wasn't God's desire for them that their carcasses would drop off in the wilderness after 40 years and that they would never enter into, it's called, his rest. Now, rest here has two understandings. You know, it's interesting, this word for rest is only found in Hebrews and in one other place in the Scripture, and that is in Acts. In the New Testament, the word rest is not used anywhere else. And in Acts, the way that is used, it's used as the place where God permanently dwells. Rest. So if you study and you understand what rest is, it has two meanings. It means literally that relief, right? Rest is relief from labor, relief from toil, relief from pressure, relief from stress. It's a relief. It's a place of relief. It is a place, if you will, of solace or comfort. It's a place of protection. You know, it's kind of like being on base when you're playing hide-and-go-seek. You know, I don't know how many of y'all, but we ought to get together and have a good church game of hide-and-go-seek, all ages. You know, different rules for different ages, of course. But it's when you're on base and nobody can touch you and nothing can happen. You're safe. It's a place of safety, a place of solace. And the warning here to Hebrew believers who are undergoing terrible tragedy. And by the way, by way of review, or in case you weren't here last week, one of the things we saw as we were introduced was the ultimate outcome of the persecution of the Christians at Jerusalem. What happened in 70 AD when Jerusalem was sacked? What happened to the people that lived there? What? They were killed or exiled. And when they were exiled, they weren't exiled as Roman citizens. They were exiled as slaves. What happened to the Christians who were persecuted by those who were killed or exiled? They were already gone because of the persecution. They already had. Now, how many of you like to leave home? There are some people, you're travelers. I'll be honest with you, I was born in Kansas, and if God hadn't moved me, I'd be in Kansas. That's where I'd be at. I'm a homebody, or I used to be. Now home is Fort Lauderdale, and I don't want to move anywhere else. I like to visit places, but I want to be home. I'm not a person that, some people just, they can move at the drop of a hat, you know, they're ready to make new friends, and not me. I want to be where I'm at. And I want to be where God's called me. And I'm attached. I'm entrenched. Can you imagine being Jewish, being from the one place in the world that you're from, that you really have a rightful claim to because God's given it to you, and then being driven out of there by your own brethren? Can you imagine that? I can't imagine my family running me out of Kansas. I mean, I'm talking about a good family. I can't imagine my family saying, hey, you know, don't come back. Get out of here. If I see you again, I'll turn you in. I'll have the council get you. I'll tell Saul. You know Saul, the one that organized Stephen's death, threw rocks at him? Well, I'll tell you what, when they come for you, I'm going to pick up a rock and I'm going to be the first one to hit you in the face with it. Your family. That's rough, isn't it? You think it'd be fun to leave? But I'm going to tell you something. The end result was when Jerusalem was sacked, those individuals that were driven out all survived. They all made it. They weren't part of God's judgment of Jerusalem. So sometimes when we're going through a hardship, sometimes all we can see are the circumstances that we're going through, but we don't see God's protection. Sometimes we think, God, you're not protecting me. God, you're not taking care of me. And yet, while it was all happening, God was taking care. We'll see that conclusion when we finish Hebrews. But I want to point it out to you because it's important for us to have the overall picture, the overall view. Because how are we going to make it through this testing or temptation or hard time of Jesus Christ? Okay, now, the reference in this passage of Scripture, the question is, or the statement, the warning passage here is, don't harden your hearts. And to whom again is Hebrews addressed? You tell me. Believers of Jesus or unbelievers?
Believers.
Believers. Friend, I want to tell you something. It's possible for anyone who knows Jesus to get hard. To get hard. You ever been hurt enough that it just doesn't hurt the same anymore? Or you just kind of get a little bit dulled to it? Where you just kind of get hard? A little hardened to it. And it isn't though as though it's okay or you're okay with it being that way, but you're just like, I've been through this enough that, you know what, it's just, I'm not going to let it affect me the way it used to affect me. It's not going to break me the way it used to break me. I've seen, it's really tragic when it happens in a relationship. I've seen husbands and wives, I've seen them get hard. You know what I'm talking about? I mean, it used to be, he wouldn't have ever said something like that, but if he slipped and said it, she'd cry. The day comes, she doesn't cry. She just shrugs. Heard that enough. Well, that's a sad day, isn't it? It's a terrible day. Used to be that her words, when she'd put him down or when she would say things, just really got him. I mean, it just really bothered him. Just really hurt. And it got to where, yeah, she'd been saying that the whole time we've been married. And it doesn't matter anymore. It doesn't make any difference. And he gets hard. And all of a sudden, you got two people that are in a relationship together, but it's like they, because of that hardness, what is missing anymore? If you get hard, what you're missing is a love, right? The love gets cold. Hardness causes you to grow cold. And what is the warning here is that the children of Israel who are rejoicing so much when God led them out of Egypt and delivered them and gave them the wealth of their masters, and when God did such a mighty work, and they were so thrilled about it, such devotion, all of a sudden they've gotten a little bit calloused. And they've gotten a little bit, well, God, if you're going to judge us, just judge us. I don't care. And, you know, I've met Christians that are like, you know what, I'm going to live how I'm going to live. And I know God's going to deal with me, but you know what, He's just going to do what He's going to do. And they kind of bow up and they kind of arch their backs and kind of like, you know what, do what you're going to do, God. And they get hard. Christians get hard. And this is a rather stern warning, and it's a rather extreme warning, won't you agree? Because the consequences of the hardening of the hearts against Moses and rejecting God was that God said, okay, enough's enough. You've complained against me too many times, and you're not going into Canaan. And the tragedy of it all is the loss. The way the Scripture refers to them, it says their carcasses dropped off, or their carcasses died in the wilderness. I mean, being referred to, your body being referred to as a carcass. It's a rather hard description, isn't it? It's kind of a very impersonal way of saying things. And the warning is, you don't want to be like that. You don't want to be like where you say, I don't care if I go into Canaan. I don't care if I die in the wilderness. I don't care what God does. Because you're hard. And the Hebrew Christians are being warned of a couple of things, and we'll look at that warning. First of all, in verse 9, the illustration is, when your fathers tempted me, proved me, and saw my works 40 years. By the way, if you're looking for the passage that this comes from, it's Psalm 95, which incidentally is all about worship. It's all about worship of God. And then the second part of the passage goes back to the psalmist David saying, harden not your hearts as in the day of temptation. It's a direct quote. This is a direct quote of Psalm 95. So here's what God said in verse 10. Wherefore I was grieved with that generation. And God is merciful, isn't He? You know, you're here this morning and you say, well, my parents sinned and God is judging me. No, you're wrong about that. God didn't judge the generation, the children of these hardened individuals who He swore wouldn't enter into His rest. And He said, your children will enter in, but you won't. God doesn't judge. You don't get residual judgment from God. God judges the guilty, not the innocent. I swear in my wrath, or I'm sorry, verse 10, I was grieved and I said, they do always err in their heart and they have not known my ways. Do you think that when the children of Israel murmured against Moses and said he's a bad leader, do you think they were right about it? He was the best leader in the world. You tell me one person who could have led a couple of million people out of bondage and slavery and stuck with them in the wilderness. You know, Moses was one in however many the population of the world was at the time. What's the population of the world today? How many billion is it now? It's like 7 billion? What? Is it
7 billion?
About 7 billion? Is it not? Maybe. It's vastly increasing.
Mm-hmm.
Whatever the population of the world is, Moses is one in that many billion. He's the only one. And the children of Israel complained about him. And what could Moses do? It was what God had prepared him for. I mean, literally, the guy's 80 years old when God calls him to lead these children out. Dies when he's 120. What a life. Living in the wilderness with a bunch of people that hate you. Leading them, serving them, and they hate you. They disregard you and they speak out against you. They complain against him. Can you imagine? It's hard, hard-heartedness. And it says in verse 12, the Bible says, take heed, brethren, lest there be in any of you an evil heart of unbelief. And notice the evidence of an evil heart of unbelief in departing from the living God. So these individuals, they said, God, you know, when Moses went up onto the mountain to be with God, and they immediately erect a golden calf and say, these be the gods, Aaron said, these be the gods which brought you out of Egypt. Do you think they knew who led them out of Egypt? Do you think there was some kind of a, you know, mental fog? And they didn't know who the cloud by day and the pillar of fire by night, which is the presence of God literally by their camp? You think they didn't know who led them out of Egypt? How in the world could somebody go from worshiping God to saying, this calf that Aaron made is God? How could you do it? Got to be hard. You say, Pastor, that's nuts. Well, hardness is nuts, my friend. It doesn't make any sense. It isn't logical. Unbelief, my friend, is not based in logic. If you reject God, friend, let me say to you, do not reject Him for good reason. You reject Him for a hardness. You reject Him because of an irrational reason. But there's no logic in it. There's no reason for it. And so these individuals, they're hard. And it goes on to say in verse 12, the way that believers demonstrate is departing from the living God. Now I want to say that this is not salvific. What do you mean? Well, this doesn't have to do with being born again. This has to do with fellowship. This has to do with staying close to the Lord Jesus. This has to do, you know, you can turn from Jesus and still have eternal life. This passage of Scripture is talking about individuals who are identifying nationally with unbelief. And in identifying with unbelief, it's not that they're, you know, or in unbelief, it's not that they are turning against Jesus per se. Here's what they're saying. You know what? I mean, to openly worship, I could get killed for it, okay? So I'm just going to keep it a secret that I'm a follower of Jesus. I'm just not going to talk about it all the time, okay? The people don't want to hear about it, and so I'm not going to mention it. And when I'm pressured to do something that goes against my faith, I'm just going to go along with it because I don't want to attract attention or draw attention. And what it is a hardness. It's a lack of love for the one who loved them. Listen, my friend, when Jesus died on the cross because of sin, do you think there's shame in the one who never sinned? Not only becoming a man, being lower than the angels, identifying as a man, but being a servant of men, and then being judged as a sinner. Do you think there's shame in the cross? Whose shame did Christ bear? Mine. Ours. When Jesus died for sin, He died for the things that I've done, the things I should be ashamed for. Jesus Christ became those sins, became sin for us, took God's judgment for me, and identified with me. And Jesus didn't identify with my good side. He identified with my sin. It bore my shame. And the idea of saying, well, I'm not gonna wear my religion on my sleeve. I'm not gonna go around and, you know, telling everybody I'm a follower of Jesus. The idea is, he was unashamed of me, but I'm ashamed of him. In other words, I don't want the shame. If you proclaim Jesus, there'd be hissing. There'd be spitting. There would be repercussions. There'd be people that would avoid you, that would speak down on you and would rebuke you. There would be shame from it. But nobody likes to be in the authority. I'm going to tell you something. Nobody likes to be in a place where you are a minority or spoken against. It's amazing how many people believe something but will keep quiet about it just because they don't want the shame of it. I joked about this a while back, but when we were closing out our storage unit, I went over to the place across the street, and there was a guy that came in. It was when they found out, you know, the Russian bomber, or the Russian, I'm sorry, not the Russian bomber, the airplane that was, the Russian airplane that was taken down. It was, I don't know, it was hijacked.
Or,
yeah. And they said they found out that the guys that did that were affiliated. You know, the guy had a cousin who was in ISIS. And I said, I spoke up, and I said that had nothing to do with Islamic terrorism. I said it wasn't terrorism in the room. And everybody started nodding their heads with me. Like, yeah, you know, I don't know why you bring up that guy's cousin was ISIS that did it. I found out the guys that did it were affiliated with ISIS. I said it had nothing to do with Islamic terror. Everybody's like, yeah. And I said, yes, it was! I didn't yell that bad, but I did. I was like, yes, it was! To all the people there. And they're all like, yeah, it was. It's amazing. You know, if somebody speaks up, nobody wants to be the person that says, yeah, it was. You know, sometimes you have that person that doesn't mind, but it's pretty rare that somebody wants to be pointed out in a minority and have everybody, you know what, that's hate speech that you're talking there. You're just, and start judging you. I'm going to tell you something. They had ISIS affiliations, and it was Islamic terror. You can call it what you want to, but that's what it was. But yet, there are places, I'm going to tell you, you go over to Albertsons, not Albertsons anymore, Safeway. Go over to Albertsons, which is now Safeway, and stand in line. And you say, you know that Russian jet that was blown up? Do you guys know that was Islamic terror? I'm going to tell you, the cashier will judge you. The people in line will judge you. They'll say, you know, you just don't need to be, you know, you're making them mad. You need to quit saying stuff like that. You understand what I'm saying? There's a shame with identification with an ideology, even if you believe it. You may believe it, but you're going to be shamed for it. And friend, there's pretty big shame for just letting people know. I mean, when you became a follower of Jesus, the first thing you did was went out in public and got baptized. And you're identifying with his death, with his burial, his resurrection. When you got baptized, everybody knew you believed in Jesus. It was public. When we talk about baptism as a public statement of our faith, it was a public statement of your faith to unbelievers, to the very people who were going to say, I marked you now. I know you're following Jesus. We're done. There's a shame to it. Friend, I want to remind you about something. The first thing is this. There is a rest for those who are persecuted. There is a rest for the weary. There is a rest for those individuals that undergo shame for the cause and the sake of Jesus Christ. And though you and I cannot identify in the extreme way that the Holy Spirit is identifying with the Hebrew Christians, we know what it is, don't we? You know what it is. You know, it's amazing. I'll be sitting in a lobby or a room somewhere and I'll start talking to somebody about Jesus and somebody will oppose it. It's amazing when I speak up and I say something, it's amazing how I find out most of the people in the room agree with me. Nobody was going to say anything. Nobody was going to stand. You know something? You know, in our country, to talk about Jesus it's not cool right now, is it? Talking about in a public forum. Try praying. You know, I the other day I Googled my name. One of the things that came up in my name, you Google Pastor Ryan Price, one of the first things that come up happened, I think, like 15 years ago. It was a news article in Delray Beach. They called me and asked me if I would pray to open the city commission meeting, and I did. I went and prayed. And I said, I prayed for God to bless the people that were there, to give the leaders wisdom, and that, you know, everything that was done ultimately would be to God's glory. And then I said, in Jesus' name, amen. And I sat there for the whole meeting. The meeting was closed, and I left, and they reopened the meeting. And it made the newspaper, because I prayed in Jesus' name. And I was just like, you know, and everybody there was like, well, you know, I don't have a problem with it, but some people might, so we're not going to accept that. And they had a real issue with me praying. They just asked me to pray. And I, you know, I just said, well, you know, they asked me to pray, so I did. If I didn't pray to God because of what Jesus has done, I have no access to God. Listen, my friend, if you pray to God in your sinful state, you're praying to a God who is your enemy because of your sin. He's your judge. It's like saying, hey, you should condemn me to hell. Would you do this favor for me? But when I come to God through Jesus, Jesus died for my sin. Because of what Jesus did, I got what Jesus is. I'm God's beloved son. I'm the person who's never sinned. I'm the only person who's ever lived, who's ever fulfilled the law and always pleased the Father. That's it. That's my standing before God. And when I pray to God in Jesus' name, my friend, God says, yes, you're my beloved son. I'll do it. And so we see that because of unbelief, the children of Israel couldn't enter in. And friend, these individuals who are ashamed of Jesus and they're unwilling to identify with Him, hey, they're not going to enter into rest. The idea is there's no rest, but there's no rest for a person. So the very thing that motivates them, what would motivate a believer in Jesus to not publicly, openly identify with Him?
Fear.
They need relief, right? It's too much. It's over. I mean, they used to identify with Him, it just became too much. They said, oh, I just can't do it anymore. Fear. But they wanted a relief from the persecution. And friend, I have to say to you that if you're going to follow Jesus, you need to understand you're all in. But there is a rest. Let's finish up. In verse 15, this is in Psalm 95 again. While it is said, today if you will hear His voice, harden not your hearts as in the provocation. For some, when they had heard, did provoke. Howbeit, not all that came out of Egypt by Moses. And the argument here is that though that may be what many do, that is not what you have to do. Aren't you so glad that you don't just have to do what everybody does? Listen, God's not going to judge you for what the person sitting next to you has done. God's not going to hold you accountable for the choices that those that surround you have made. Albeit those choices may affect you, God doesn't hold you accountable for it. Listen, you're a child, and your parents expose you to things that you wish you'd never known. God's not going to hold you accountable for that. God's going to hold you accountable for what you've done, not for what they've done. Listen, you're a spouse, you're a wife, and you're afraid, you know, God's going to judge our family because of what I know. God's going to judge your husband for what he does. And God's going to judge you for what you do. And you can be part of a majority. Listen, mobs are almost always wrong, aren't they? You ever see a mob make a good decision? No, a mob makes a bad decision, and it's a majority decision. And you can go along with the mob if you want to. And you'll just be as wrong as you can be. But you don't have to go along. If you stand up to the mob, what's likely to happen? At the very least, you'll be overrun. At the very least, you'll be overruled. But the end result is that you'll be right. You'll have done right. You know, Joseph Smith would have been sentenced to capital punishment if he hadn't been lynched. That's kind of an aside, but you know, it's amazing that the occult of Mormonism has thrived on making Joseph Smith a martyr when he committed capital crimes, not by the scores, but by the thousands. And today, Joseph Smith is this great religious leader because he's a martyr. A mob thought they'd take care of him, thought they'd take care of business. You know, you've got to let God take care of business. You don't have to be part of the error. Sometimes we think we've got a good idea or a good way to do something, and we go with what the majority thinks. You better go with what God thinks. For some, in verse 16, when they heard, did provoke, howbeit not all that came out of Egypt by Moses. Remember, there were two guys that went in. They were spies in the land. There were 10 spies. 2 were good, 8 were bad. Mm-hmm. Or 12 spies. 10 were good, 2 were bad. Yeah, might as well make it 12. And Joshua and Caleb were the only two that entered into the land. They had a long life after they went into the land. It was a blessed life. It was a wonderful life. They didn't go with what the majority said. They went against the majority. They were right. With whom was he grieved 40 years? Was it not with them that had sinned, whose carcasses fell in the wilderness? God didn't spend 40 years grieved with Joshua and Caleb. They had 40 years of God's blessing while everybody else was judged. And to whom swore he that they should not enter into his rest, but to them that believed not? So we see that they could not enter in because of unbelief. And we'll conclude today by saying this. My friend, I don't know what it is that would hinder you from doing what you know God wants. A Christian, it could be as simple as just making a covenant or a promise to God of faithfulness. God, I'll serve you. God, I'll do this. God, I'll tell people about Jesus. I'll tell this person, God, I will. You made a covenant promise to God. And God's holding you accountable to it. But because you want relief, you're no longer doing what you promised God you'd do. You committed to a way of life. You said, God, I'm going to live this way. I'm going to live for Jesus. I'm going to do this. And all of a sudden, you went back on it. You began to do those things which you promised God you would not do. Or you neglected to do those things which you promised God you would do. Let me just tell you something. The reason you did it is because you needed a break, because you needed relief, because you felt like, I can't make it. And you forgot that Jesus Christ is able to nourish and sustain you. You can do right and God will help. You have a whole majority in the wilderness whose carcasses died there, but the mention is made, but not everybody. Some people thrived in the wilderness. Some people made it through the hard times. Listen, when Caleb was 80 years old, he went to Joshua and said, you know what, God promised me a land. Give me that mountain where the giants are. I want that mountain. You know that song, I want that mountain, I want that mountain. Hey, listen, that was Caleb, 80 years old. Claimed the promises of God and saw God's blessing, and his generations that followed him saw the blessing. I love the name Caleb. What a great name. If you have a son, to name your son Caleb. Good, strong man that believed in God. Joshua, a courageous man that stood up and said, if it seems evil to you to serve the Lord, choose you this day whom you'll serve. But as for me and my house, we'll serve the Lord. And the whole nation of Israel that had grown up with their parents dropping off in the wilderness said with Joshua, we will serve the Lord! Because of a man that had courage. God give us some Christians that say it doesn't really matter what people who can't handle the hardship do. Because, friend, caving, failing, falling is no way to handle it. It's just a way to ensure that you don't enter into rest. The children of Israel said the wilderness is too hard for us, and so they just, that became their career. That's all they ever saw. You think it's too tough to serve God because of the times? Well, my friend, the only way to get out of the times is to serve God. And the day will come, friend, whether it's in this life or whether it's in eternity, the day will come, my friend, when there will be rest. There is a rest for those that are the children of God. There's a rest that's promised. And the question for you here today is this. God knows your heart, doesn't He? And you know the truth as God shows it to you, don't you? And if God were to look at you, is there a hardness? Is there, I know I should, but I'm not going to because? It's an audacious statement, isn't it? And it has consequences because we know God's heart to those that say, you know what? I know what you've done for me, God, but it's too hard. It's too much. Let me just tell you something. Jesus died for us. God doesn't need some kind of sacrifice. The idea that our hardship is because there's some kind of sacrifice for God is nonsensical. Jesus is the one who is the sacrifice. He died for us. And He did so that He could sustain us and get us through the hardship. And I promise you, friend, if you think that God is causing the difficulty in your life, you're mistaken about its source. God is not the source of hardship. But Jesus Christ is the source of nurture. He's the one who can get you through the hard times. He's the one by whom you can make it. I love what Paul said when he said, I can do all things through Christ, which strengthens me. And Christian, I'm here today to tell you, you can make it. I don't know what you're going through. You know, probably there are some people in this room that you're the only one that knows. And the truth is, if you shared what you're going through, people wouldn't even understand because they've never been through it. And they couldn't even relate to it. They couldn't honestly say, yeah, I get what you're going through. But there is one who in Hebrews, the scripture says, we have not an high priest which cannot be touched with the feeling of our infirmity. Who is in all points tempted like as we are, yet without sin. My friend, Jesus Christ will get you through it and He'll help you enter into His rest. There is rest for the children of God. There's a rest for you. It's only promised to those that don't harden their hearts. So as the question began, as the Holy Spirit looks at your heart, what's there? Maybe you've never trusted Jesus. And my friend, I'll just tell you something. Jesus is the only way. It's very exclusive, and you just can't harden your heart to it. He's God. God gets to decide how we come to Him. We can't tell Him, well, you know what? I want to do it my way. I want good works. Well, my friend, you're ignoring your sin. The Bible says all sin comes short of the glory of God. And God is a just judge. He has to judge sin. He must judge sin or He isn't righteous. But He's just, not because He judges sin. He's just to forgive sin. He's just to cleanse sin. See, God's justice is not in His right to judge. It is in His right to forgive sin. And He is just to forgive sin because Jesus died for it. God has the right to forgive you, my friend, and He has earned Himself that right by His Son dying for your sin. You say, I don't want Jesus. My friend, Jesus is the means, the source to God's forgiveness. And He said, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by Me. You hear this morning, don't harden your heart to Jesus. Don't be hard to Jesus. You've received Jesus as your Savior, and you realize that living for God is, boy, it's not a sprint, it's a marathon, and there's some enduring that's involved with it. And you say, it's just too much. I'm just gonna drop it. I'm gonna forget about it. I'm just gonna go back. The things that I promised God that I wouldn't have in my life, it's too much. I'm gonna have them. The things that I promised God I'd do, the service that I committed to Him, you know, it's too much. I'm not gonna no. Just my friend, I just want to tell you something. Jesus will help you. Don't harden your hearts. You harden your hearts, you won't have rest. So how is it that a person who's going through something today could have rest?
Through Jesus.
Father, I pray that You would help us to both understand what's been preached this morning, but Father, help us to believe, as we know that that belief is a choice. God, if there would be any in this place this morning that has not believed in Jesus, Lord, I pray that You would help them to see that they need to make that choice. Father, if there's anyone here today that's a follower of Jesus and yet they're considering going back, or they've hardened their hearts and they don't have the love for You they had, and they think that it's just too hard and there's no rest for the children of God, God, I pray that You'd help them to see the truth. And see that the way to rest is through following Jesus. God, we know that we pray this prayer because of what Jesus has done. I ask for Your blessing on the invitation now, that Your Holy Spirit would speak to hearts of individuals and You have Your way with us. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Mm-hmm. While you remain in your seats, I want to explain the invitation. The invitation we usually have, not always, but we usually have at the end of our service. And we just invite you to respond to the message of God's Word. While we're preaching the Word of God, it's quite possible that the Holy Spirit and the circumstances of your life have made the message this morning very real. You're here this morning and you see that Jesus is the only way for eternal life. That's a reality, and that's something that every one of us has to settle. We have to make a decision. You're here among friends. You're here among people who have received Jesus and who know what it is to be an unbeliever and to go into and to believe and to receive God's Spirit living in us. And the invitation is for you to receive Jesus this morning. You haven't trusted Jesus as your Savior. Friend, you could today, and it's your choice. And we would urge you to take advantage of that opportunity to trust Jesus. God is always waiting with open arms and saying, come to Me. And He has done what's necessary to be just to forgive our sins because of Jesus. That's the invitation if you haven't received Jesus. If you're a believer and you can identify with the hardship, you'd say, I wouldn't be so arrogant as to say that my hardship is equivalent. But your hardship's very real. And what you're going through is very legitimately difficult. But you've realized today, if you harden your heart to God, there's no rest. There's no end. There's no solace or comfort. There's no going back and going forward. And the Holy Spirit here today has said, hey, trust Jesus. Come to Jesus. My friend, I'm going to tell you something. You'll be able to enter into rest right now. You'll be able to take your burdens. You'll be able to cast them on Him. And you'll have Jesus bear your load, bear your burden. And you'll have rest before you leave this place this morning. And I would urge you to take advantage of that opportunity that we give you at the invitation this morning. Again, it's not my invitation. It's God's invitation. If He's spoken to you, you respond. I want to ask, if you're physically able to do so, if you would stand to your feet and open up your blue hymn books to page 242. The pianist isn't with us this morning. Brother Taj is standing in the back of the room. And he's there and he's got a Bible. He'd be available to pray with someone if you want to pray with him about something. You need counsel. But as we sing the song of invitation this morning, I would urge you, just do business with God on your own. Jesus, I come. And as we sing, Jesus, I come, if that's the prayer of your heart, you come to Him right now. We're going to